¿Y ellos cuándo pueden ver el
Ya están viendo.
ya? ¿Y el PowerPoint?
Lo están viendo también
Ya,
ahora.
también. Ah,
Ajá. Todo lo que estén ahí, ya están
ya. Ya,
viendo.
ellos están viendo.
Ahí hay un
El equipo
alumno,
se
solo
va
está
ahí.
conectado.
Ya.
Cuenca, falta Guayaquil y Quito.
Ya.
¿Podemos esperar a que se conecten o puede iniciar? Sí.
Ya. Estarán al
Yo creo que
comienzo.
por tiempo ya no podrá
Empezamos, ¿no es
iniciar.
cierto? Ya. Y para iniciar tengo que tocar, coger algo aquí.
Solo.
Solo.
Está abierto.
Ah,
Este rojo.
no. Ya. Y escucha. Good afternoon, dear all. Welcome to the study of this new course in your master program. My name is Vanessa Toro, and I will be your tutor during these 2 months. As all of you know, the course that you are going to study with me is Classroom Language Assessment. As I told you, my name is Vanessa Toro, and I will help you during these 2 months with important information related to classroom language assessment. First of all, I would like to share with you this quote. I really like this quote. Tell me and I'll forget. Show me and I may remember. Involve me and I learn. I really like this quote because I think that all of you and also all English teachers have to be aware of this. If we just tell our students how to do things, they will forget what we tell them, okay? It is really important to involve them in the learning process, okay? And through this course, we are going to learn many ways of teaching English, and of course, many ways of assessing our students in order to know if they are getting any progress with the methodology we are using in order to teach the language. As I told you, this quote is really useful because we don't have just to tell our students how to do things or to show them how to do things, but the most important thing here is to involve them in the process, to involve them in the many different activities. In this way, they will be able to learn and also to put into practice what they have learned. You know, this course is about different ways of assessing students, okay? There are many different techniques, many different types of assessments, and all of you are aware of them, okay? But maybe we are not aware of all of the alternatives, or we are not aware of all of the techniques or tasks that we can use in order to assess the learning process. What I would like to share with you about this course is that you will be provided with the necessary principles of language assessment. Of course, about some techniques, tasks, and many different alternatives that will be really helpful for us in order to assess English learners. It is important to remind you, because you all know that this course is taught in the third semester. It is a 4-credit course. For this reason, we will be studying during 128 hours. As you can observe in this slide, we will be working 12 hours a week. In this way, you are going to work in an autonomous way, okay? 12 hours a week. and 4 hours a week will be dedicated to work with the tutor. Okay, we are going to be working with many different activities in this. In every week, you can also contact the tutor in order to talk about the different activities that you have to complete or to ask questions related to the course. It is also important to share with you some activities. As you know, there are activities in which you have to check information in advance in order to participate in some chats, in some videos. You will be also working with an academic forum. In fact, you are working on this activity right now, or you are going to be working on this activity in next week, okay? Another activity that is really useful for you is the wiki. All of you have been working on activities like the activities that I have already shared with you, okay? As I told you, our course is Classroom Language Assessment. We are going to focus on the many different ways in order to assess English learners, and all the information related to assessment and also language testing will be very necessary for you in order to participate on chats, videos, also in the forum and in the wiki, okay? I am going to share with you these activities, but now in a general way, I would like to share with you the way in which we are going to work, okay? This is the first week of studies, okay? We are right now officially beginning with our course. This is the first week. Then the next week, we will be working on some activities that corresponds to the second week, okay? Our first chart will be carried out next Wednesday, okay? Remember that you were assigned class A and class B. We have two groups of students, and the activities were divided. In this way, next week, I am going to work with class A, the first chat with class A, at 5 p.m. until 6 p.m., okay? The same chat will be carried out with class B from 6 p.m. until 7 p.m. This activity will be developed next Wednesday, okay? February 22nd. Then, as you know, we will be working on some video conferences. The first video conference will be carried out on March the 1st. So with class A, we are going to work from 6 until 7 p.m., okay? As you could observe here, you are going to be working on different hours, okay? If our first chart was conducted or was carried out at 5, the next week, for example, video 1 with class A will be carried out at 6, okay? Then the coming chat, that is chat 2, will be carried out at 6 p.m. on March 8th, okay? So this is the way in which we are going to work, okay? Of course, I am going to provide you with all the information in advance for you to be prepared with the topics that are going to be considered in order to develop all of these activities. Now, I would like to share with you the assignments that you are going to complete. Remember that we have 8 weeks of study, and you are going to be working with 4 assignments or 4 tasks, okay? Assignment Number one, as you know, you have to make a chart, and in this chart, you have to compare formative and summative forms of assessment, okay? This is one of the topics that we are going to study, formative and summative assessment, okay? I think that all of you are aware of formative and summative types of assessment, okay? So we are going to recall information about these two types of assessment, but at the same time, you are going to put into practice what you have learned, okay? What you have to do here is to analyze additional information, okay? You have to analyze additional information from the information that you have in your textbook, okay? You have information about these types of assessment, but it is also necessary that you go to some other sources, just two sources or three. You are free to decide if you use two sources or three more sources in order to support your ideas, okay? Remember that this is a chart and you are going to compare these two types of assessment, but in the chart, it is necessary that you include your opinions about formative and summative forms of assessment, but it is also necessary that you support your ideas with the information provided from some authors. Activity one, or assignment number one, was divided in two parts, okay? The first part is the chart in which you are going to compare these types of assessment. The second part of this assignment is to look for some of the tasks or assignments that you have designed that are formative in nature, okay? So all of you are teaching English. All of you have sent some tasks or assignments to your students. What are you going to do? What you have to do is to go back to the assignments that you have sent your students, and you have to analyze them. You have to decide if they are summative or formative, okay? After that, you have to choose just one of those assignments in order to complete this activity. You have to analyze the assignment, and after that, what you have to do? You have to write in your own words a 300-word essay in which you explain the reasons for applying that type of assessment with your students. Why you used that assignment and why you used that formative assignment with your students, okay? Here you have to provide your reasons. You have to provide your opinion in order to support your choice, okay? In addition, you have to explain why you think the task you selected is formative, okay? In relation to assignment number two, okay, concerning the second assignment, what you have to do is to write in your own words a 400-word essay, and what you have to do here is to describe why a test you have designed applies the five principles of language assessment. This is another topic, okay? Principles of language assessment, or principles of language testing. This is another topic, another important topic that we are going to cover during this course. And what you have to do is to check, is to analyze these five principles of language assessment, and you have also to describe, you have also to analyze one of the tests you have designed. And after that, you have to prepare your essay, and you have to share there your opinions, to tell why you think the test you design applies the five principles of language assessment. Something important is to analyze additional information in books or journals, at least two sources, to support your ideas. Yeah, you have to be aware that you are going to provide your test, you are going to write your essay, you are going to share with me your ideas about why you think the test you design applies the five principles of language assessment or testing, but it is not enough. It is also useful to provide some information from other authors in order to support your ideas. In relation to assignment number three, we are going to focus here on test specifications. Maybe you are aware of this type of format that we can use in order to plan our test. This test specification format is like the outline, okay? This is the planning of our test. We are going to talk a little bit more about this test specification format. But in a general way, what you have to do is to provide here some examples of the tasks that you are going to use in the test, what your students are going to do, okay? For example, the first information that you have to share is the general description. In this general description, you have to provide some information about the test. What are you going to test here? Okay, what are the skills that you are going to focus on in order to design the test? Once you have provided this general description of your test, you have to continue with some prompt attributes. In this case, what you have to do is to provide information about some examples that you are going to use in order to assess listening, speaking, reading, and writing. It is in the case of deciding on testing the four language skills, okay? You are going to assess listening, but here, in a general way, you have to say, for example, we are going to assess, or I am going to assess listening skills. So you have to provide a general description here. You are going to provide, for example, some videos. You are going to provide some listening passages, documentaries, in order to assess these listening skills, okay? Once you have provided these prompt attributes, what you have to do is to provide information about the response attributes. Are you going to use selected responses, or you are going to use constructed responses? If we talk about selected responses, you have to say, for example, multiple choice items are going to be used. In this case, when we talk about selected responses, it means that we are going to provide students with some objective section. In this way, we can provide, for example, matching activities in which our students have just to select the responses. If you use constructed responses, we mean that we are going to provide students with some tasks in which they have to produce. In this way, we are talking about open-ended questions. Okay? In this way, they will be providing additional information. They will have to construct their responses. They will have to produce. We are going to ask them to write maybe a paragraph. This is a constructed response task. Then, in relation to the sample items, it is necessary to provide some examples. They are just examples. It is not your test, okay? Here, you can provide, for example, in relation to listening. Yeah, you have to describe here the way in which you are going to assess your students, and also one task, okay, for your for you to know how the items will look like in the test. It is for you to have an idea of the items that will be included in your test. After that, at the end, it is necessary to provide a specification supplements. With a specification supplements, we mean that you have to provide an example of the material that you are going to use in order to design your test. If we think about reading, maybe we have to provide here a reading passage, okay? A reading passage that was taken from a book. You have to provide the reading passage, we have to provide the source also. The specification supplements part is really helpful because in this section you will provide the material that you are going to use. If you are going to assess speaking, maybe you decide on using a video for your students to watch the video, and after that to ask some questions, to answer some questions in an oral way. So you have to provide the link of the video because this is the material that you will be using in order to assess speaking skills. Of course, now I am helping you with some information, but in a general way. But remember that during this course, you can contact me. I am also going to be providing you with more detailed information about each one of the tasks that you have to complete. What about assignment number 4? This is the last assignment, and what you have to do is to design sample items focused on the 4 language skills. Okay, listening, speaking, reading, and writing. In this case, what you have to do? Design sample items. Yeah? But you are going to design a test. You are going to construct a test with these sample items. I am going to provide you with a form in which you have to include all of these sample items, okay? We have been talking about each one of the assignments. Now, I am going to share with you the due dates for these assignments, okay? The essay that you have to send as part of assignment 1 will be sent until February 23rd, okay? This is the due date for assignment number 1, February 23rd. For assignment number 2 is March 9th, okay? Assignment number 3, March 23rd. And assignment number 4, March 29th in this case. Remember that some of the activities that you have to complete have due dates. In this case, you have to send also the distance evaluation. What you have to consider here is the dates that you have available in order to send this distance evaluation. Remember that we are working every week, okay? You have to send assignment number 1 during the second week. But at the end, you have to send the complete distance evaluation. Remember that you have the objective part and the essay part. You have to complete the objective part and also the essay part. And this essay part is going to be sent through Eva, the 4 assignments. Yeah, through Eva on March 27th. You are going to be provided with 3 days in order to upload this assignment, okay? Now remember that at the end of the semester you have to take the on-site evaluation. Okay? In June the 1st and 2nd you will be taking this on-site evaluation. These are some important dates that you have to consider, because during these dates you have to complete some other activities that are part of this semester. All of you know the resources that we are going to use. The book that you will be using is Practical Language Testing. Okay? Folger is the author of this textbook, and this is the textbook that we are going to use during this course. Language Assessment, Principles and Classroom Practices is also another important book for you, because it provides different types of tasks that you can use. Of course, the guide is really necessary, because it will guide you during this course. You have also some self assessment, self evaluations at the end of each unit, and it is very necessary, because through this self evaluation you will be able to assess your progress. It is important to let you know that we will be studying 6 units. It is important to check the topics that we are going to study in each one of these units. In unit number 1, we will focus on testing and assessment in context. This is the general topic, testing and assessment in context. Within this unit, we will cover the test purpose, the test in educational systems, unintended consequences of testing, and also the principles of language assessment. These 4 topics will be covered in Unit 1. As you know, if we are going to test, it is very necessary to be aware of the purpose. If we don't know the purpose for assessing our students, it will be very difficult for us to select the materials, to select the items in order to assess them. Okay? It is very necessary to have a clear idea of our purpose for testing our students or for assessing their progress. In relation to the principles of language assessment, it is important to remind you that these principles should be applied to formal and informal tests. Remember that we can assess our students in a formal way and also in an informal way. We will be covering information about this formal and informal assessment, because it is really important for us as English teachers to know about them. Practicality, reliability, validity, authenticity, and washback are the 5 principles of language assessment, and we have to consider them when designing a test, because we have to apply these 5 principles of language assessment when designing the test. Our tests have to be practical, reliable, valid, authentic, and also they have to provide positive washback to the teaching and learning process. It is important to share with you some information about these principles of language assessment. If we talk about practicality, we have to be aware that a test is practical when the test can be completed during appropriate time constraints, okay? When directions are clear, when our students understand the instruction in order to complete, in order to take the test. When we use human and material resources in a proper way. If a test is reliable, okay, we have to be aware of reliability. For a test to be reliable, they have to provide similar results in different occasions. We are going to apply the same test to the same group of students. So for a test to be reliable, the results should be similar. If they are very different, so our test is not reliable. The test should contain unambiguous items or tasks. It means that the tasks have to be clear. The tasks have to contain just one possible correct answer. Also, directions for scoring have to be clear. We have to provide information about how to score this test, about how to score each one of the items that are included in the test. If we are going to use constructed responses, we have to provide a rubric. We have to provide some criteria in order to score the test. If we talk about validity, a test is valid when it measures what it is intended to measure. If we are going to assess, for example, speaking, we have to make use of some materials, of some resources that are directly focused on assessing this speaking skill. It is not possible to make use of some other resources or activities that are not directly related to the speaking skills. The tests have to measure relevant variables, okay? We have to consider here the variables that we are going to measure. So we have to focus on the skill that we are going to test. We are going to focus on the most relevant or important variables. The test have to involve performance that sample the test criterion or objectives. In this way, for a test to be valid, we have to consider the objective and we have to consider the content that we have taught in order to use the most proper tasks in order to assess our students' learning. If we talk about authenticity, we have to consider that a test should contain items that are authentic, items that are real, items that are contextualized. Okay, we can't provide some sentences that are isolated. We have to provide our students with some context for them to understand what they have to do. As I told you, the language has to be as natural as possible. We have to provide contextualized items. In relation to the topics, they have to be relevant, meaningful, and also interesting for our students. As I told you, the tasks that we use in the test have to replicate real-world tasks. We are going to use, or it is necessary that we use some tasks that can be used in real situations. What about washback? Remember that washback can be beneficial for our students when the test gives learners feedback that enhances their language development. When the test is more formative than summative. And also, the test offers learners the opportunity to adequately prepare. Washback is the impact that tests have on the teaching and learning process. Okay, so we have to provide some appropriate feedback when testing. What about unit number two? In unit number two, we are going to focus on classroom assessment. Some important information was considered here in relation to assessment for learning, test tasks or items, alternatives in assessment, and dynamic assessment, and portfolio assessment. As you can observe here, we have five topics that are very related to the way of assessing students inside the classroom. It is important to focus on test tasks or items. As I told you, there are many different types of items that can be used in order to assess students. Multiple choice items, yes, no, and true and false items, short answer items are some examples of tasks. They are not all the tasks that we have in order to assess students. These are just some examples, but also we have many more examples, and I am going to share them with you along this course. Here, I would like to share with you these picture cue tasks. As you can observe, we are going to provide students with some pictures. After that, we can provide our students with some questions. And after that, they will be provided with some blank spaces in order to provide a response. But what they have to consider here is the picture. They have to look at the picture. After that, they have to read each one of the questions, and at the end, they have to provide their response for each one of these questions. As you can see here, test takers are provided with this picture cue stimulus. We are going to provide them with this stimulus, that is the picture cue task. What they have to do is to describe what they see. You can use this picture cue task in order to assess writing. They can see, they can read, and after that, they will write their responses. This same task, picture cue task, can be used in order to assess speaking. We can ask our students to look at the pictures, read the questions, and after that, provide an oral response. But also, we can show them just some pictures, and we can ask them the question. And after that, they will have to provide the response. As you can observe here, multiple choice responses, or just no questions, true or false questions, or matching, ordering tasks, are not the only tasks that we can use in order to assess English skills. There are many different tasks that are really meaningful and useful to assess English learners. I would like to share this other example, sentence completion tasks or dialogue completion tasks. Test takers are given time to read the sentence or the dialogue. Okay? Here, the sentence or the dialogue is incomplete. What they have to do, what our learners have to do, is to read the sentences or to read the dialogue. After that, we have to assign some time for them to prepare their responses. for them to complete the lines. In this case, or in this way, they will provide, they will complete this task. They will complete the sentence, or they will complete the dialogues. Of course, this is not the only activity that we can provide them to assess their writing skills. What we can do is to provide them an opportunity to act out this dialogue. In this way, we will be assessing writing skills, and also we will be able to assess speaking skills. We can integrate two skills here. We can assess two skills with the same activity. As you know, ordering tasks can be also used in order to assess students, okay? In this way, we provide some sentences and they have to read the sentences. We have to provide them with some time to analyze the order, and after that they have to order the task. We can provide time for them to work individually, or we can assign some time for them to work in small groups of two or three students, no more. It's enough, okay? So in this way, they will be working in small groups, they will be working in a cooperative way. And at the same time, we are assessing their understanding. In relation to tasks or items, I would like to share with you that these tasks or items are not only used to assess your students with summative purposes. As all of you observed, we have these picture cute tasks. Of course, they are not all of the tasks that we can use in order to assess students. There are many other tasks, and we are going to learn about them during the course. These tasks can be used to assess our students with summative purposes, but also with formative purposes. We can use this task to work in the class, not inside a test, in the class as a classroom activity. And after that, we can provide our students with some feedback. In relation to Unit 3, we are going to focus here on the cycle that we have to consider in order to design the test. When you design a test, or when we design a test, it is not enough to go to the book to take some information in order to write some questions. What we have to do is to consider the test design cycle. Also, we are going to cover in this unit about models of communicative competence, and also we will be talking about the construct and performance models. All of this information is important when talking about testing. What we have to consider when designing a test, as I already shared with you, is the test purpose, the test criterion. We have to consider some information about the construct, and also the way of how we can design tasks or items. In this way, the specification writing is very necessary. Why we have to be aware of the test purpose? We have to consider that before selecting the test, or before designing the test, we have to consider our purpose, okay? The purpose for testing has to be established. For example, for assessing learners' achievement, course content has to be included in the test. I am going to assess my learner's achievement. I would like to know if they have obtained any progress during the course. If I am going to assess their achievement, what I have to do? I have to consider the course content, what I have taught them. I have to focus on the content that I consider during my course, okay? But if we are going to assess test takers' proficiency, in this case, we are going to test global competence, okay? In a language or overall ability. If we are going to assess this proficiency, so it is very necessary to make use of some already designed tests like the TOEFL test, okay? Because we are not going to measure their achievement, but test the test taker proficiency. So in this way, it is not enough to choose some content that we have taught in a course. It is more general. We have to provide some global, some information that will cover their global competence, not just information from a course. It is about the test purpose, okay? What about the criterion? When we talk about the criterion, it is very necessary to be aware of the objective of my course or the objectives that I have to consider or that I established previously, okay? We have this author here, okay? According to Hambleton, the test criterion is the intended outcome of the instruction or objective. What would like to get from my students, okay? What is the goal here? It is really important. The test criterion has to be clearly stated and identified. This is important to measure the specified objectives. What are your objectives? What you have to consider, the purpose for assessing your students, and after that, the test criterion. What would you have to do here is to consider the objectives, okay? You have to go back to your course. You have to be aware of the objectives of your course. If you are going to assess, for example, your student's competence or your student's achievement in relation to a specific unit, to specific content, you have to go back to the unit. You have to establish your purpose, and you have to consider the objectives of that unit. In this way, you will be able to choose the best items in order to assess your students. In relation to the construct definition, this aspect is really important also, okay? We have to be aware of the construct. What does construct mean? Okay, according to McNamara, the test construct are those aspects of knowledge or skills that our candidate or that our students have, that have to be measured. Okay, what is their knowledge? What are the skills that they have acquired or that they have developed? Some examples here that are really good examples for you are, for example, proficiency. This is the construct. And if we are going to assess proficiency, what we have to consider here is that we need some, not a content from a unit specifically, okay? But we have to concentrate on the skills. If we are going to, if we would like to know our students' proficiency on the use of oral language, so we have to make use of some tasks or items that are focused on speaking skills, okay? If we have here, we have here this construct, communicative competence. If we talk about communicative competence, this is our construct, okay? I would like to know if my student can communicate their ideas in a written way. What I have to do is to make use of many different materials and different stimulus that will help me acquire information that let me know if my student is able to write in English. So this is the construct, okay? And what about fluency? Fluency is another construct here that we as teachers can consider at the moment of assessing our students, okay? So all of these are good examples, and we have to be aware of these examples, okay? What we have to consider is the test purpose. This is the first step, the test purpose. I would like to assess my students, but I am not going to assess them because I just want to give a test for them to take this test. But what I have to do is to consider the test purpose, after that, the criterion, that are the objectives, and after that, the construct. Yeah, if we are going to focus on communicative competence, of course, I have to make use of some methods, of some materials that will help me to assess my students in the best way. In relation to the tasks or items, and also in relation to the specification writing, it is really important. This is one of the steps that we have to consider before designing the test. Okay? Item specifications will help us to describe the prompts that will be used to elicit evidence to make inferences about test takers' abilities. Okay? The prompts or the stimulus that we are going to provide our students in order to take the test. This item specification is really important because here we will provide some samples of the items that are going to be included in the test. Okay? If we are going to use some selected responses or some constructed responses in this specification test, we will be able to provide all these items. It is really useful because we are going to have a clear idea of the tasks that we are going to include in the test. In relation to the specification writing, it is important to let you know that we will be working with a format. And this format is really useful because in this way you will have like an outline of your test. This is not the test. You have to be aware of this. The specification writing or this format is not the test. This is just a help for you in order to design the test. Unit 4 is about test specifications. How to design test specifications. Three topics will be covered in this unit. What are test specifications, specifications for testing and teaching, and also some performance conditions that are necessary in order to design the test. When talking about the specifications, it is important to consider some aspects. For example, item specifications, evidence specifications, test assembly specification, presentation specification, and delivery specification. All this information will be very useful for you in order to design these specifications, okay? When we talk about item or task specification, we refer to the input material, the sample of instructions and sample items that test takers will encounter in the test. Okay, in these item specifications, we are going to include or we are going to describe the material that we are going to use in the test, or the material that we are going to use in order to design the test. Some sample of instructions. What are the instructions that we are going to include in the test? And also some items, some sample items that our students or that our test takers will encounter in the test. If we are going to use picture cue tasks, here we have to include this, okay? We will provide our students with some picture cue tasks, with some information transfer tasks, or any other tasks that we decide to use in order to design the test. In relation to evidence specifications, in this part, we have to describe what test takers are expected to do. Their responses. What are the responses that they have to provide? For subjective tasks, it is necessary to provide rubrics in which way we are going to score these subjective tasks, these open tasks, because they will produce, they will provide some information. And it is really difficult to read an essay and try to assign a score without a rubric, okay? In the evidence specification, it is very necessary that we provide some examples of what we expect from our students. For example, if we are going to use multiple choice items, we have to describe the way in which test takers will have to provide the response. You can say, and it is easy, you can say, students will, or test takers will be provided with multiple choice tasks. They will be provided with 3 or 4 choices from which they have to select the appropriate response. One of these choices is the only correct response. So we have to describe the way in which we are going to assess. So if they choose the appropriate response, we are going to score, write this response. In relation to test assembly specification, in this part, we have to show the number of items and also the type of items that we are going to include in the test. In the test assembly specification, we have to show the number and range of items that represent the key features of the criterion. This is really important. We have to provide here some information about the number of items that we are going to include. Of course, these items have to be selected, these items have to be designed according to the criterion. They have to provide relevant information with respect to the objective or the criterion. What about the presentation specification? It shows how the items and support materials will be presented to test takers. This is really important. How I am going to present the test? Okay, I am going to use, for example, the type of the type and also the size, the font type and the size that we are going to use, spacing that we are going to use, the margin size. This is useful for us, okay? Even here, we have to provide the spacing in the part where our students are going to provide their responses. All of this information is very necessary. They will be provided with this spacing in order to provide their responses. And also the spacing between the lines, between each task, and also between the sections that are part of the test. In relation to delivery specification, the details of the test administration are presented. The time that we are going to assign our students, the space that our students will have between their desks, the number of test takers. It is in the case of having too many students, so maybe we are going to assign two or three groups of students, so it is necessary to provide this information also. The materials that will be allowed during the administration. In this case, if you are going to allow your students to use a dictionary, you can provide this information in this delivery specification. They are allowed to use dictionaries, they are allowed to use tablets or computers or books. All this information is necessary and has to be included in this delivery specification. Now, we are going to review some information about standards. Aligning test to standards. This topic will be studied in Unit 5. And the subtopics here are the definition and uses of standards, unintended consequences, using standards for harmonization and identity, and the common European framework of reference. Yeah, it is really important to be aware of the common European framework of reference, okay? Right now, English teachers are working with the national English curriculum. We have some guidelines to follow, and these guidelines or this national English curriculum has considered the common European framework of reference in order to work on these guidelines. So it is very necessary that we as English teachers learn a little bit more about this common European framework of reference. Of course, I know that you are aware of this, but it is very necessary to consider this topic when assessing our students. We have to consider some standards. Standards are very necessary because we have to follow some standards as reference when teaching English in this case. Okay? The Common European Framework describes in a comprehensive way what language learners have to learn to do in order to use a language for communication and what knowledge and skills they have to develop in order to act effectively, okay? They describe some competences. If we talk about competences, we talk about the skills, we talk about the things our students or our English learners have to be able to do. They have to put into practice what they have learned. So this Common European Framework of Reference describe these competences, describe this knowledge or skills. The framework also defines some levels of proficiency, and this level of proficiency allows learners' progress to be measured, as you have here, at each stage of learning and on a lifelong basis. If we consider this common European framework, if we consider this framework, we will be able to assess our students, taking as reference these standards, taking as reference the different levels of proficiency. In unit number 6, we will learn about testing and teaching. This course is classroom language assessment, and we are not going to focus only on the way of assessing or testing our students, but also it is necessary to focus on the way we teach, because they are really related. And for this, the topics that have been considered in this unit are washback, preparing learners for tests, and also selecting and using tests. As we already talked, washback is very necessary. Washback is the impact that our tests will have on our teaching and also on our students' learning. Okay? And McNamara argues that positive washback is provided when the teacher uses performance assessments that require integrated content and skills. We are going to provide washback to our students and positive washback, and we have to be able, or we have to consider the many different ways that we have in order to provide this positive washback. If we used only tests that required our students to select some responses, maybe we are not going to provide positive washback. If we provide our students with some opportunities to produce, with some opportunities to perform, with opportunities to use the language, and after that we provide them, or we give some feedback, we are going to be providing them with some positive washback. We have to talk with a student, we have to provide some comments on their work, we have to provide some comments on the product they have provided to the teacher. In this way, we will be providing positive washback. All this information will be provided to you, and we are going to be talking about each one of the topics during this course. What about preparing learners for tests? We have two types of preparation, and we are going to cover some information related to these two types of preparation. First of all, tests are used to familiarize learners with the test, okay? We are going to prepare, we are going to help our students to be aware of the test, and also to increase the scores of test takers. These are the two types of preparation for test, the two types that we have in order to prepare learners for test. Okay, the first, familiarize learners with the test. We are going to use some item types. When we give the test, we have to use some items that are going to be used previously, so our students are familiar to this test types, or they are familiar to these items. So they are able, they know these items, they know how to respond. Also, we have to provide similar instructions. Remember that we are teaching English every day. We use some instructions for different activities. So not the same instruction, but similar instructions have to be considered when designing the test. So our students are familiar with the instruction. They know what you want from them. Now, some practice is necessary. practice in working within time constraints. In this way, we can prepare some activities in the classroom every day. And these activities or similar activities can be used in the test, so we know the time that our students need in order to take the test. What about increasing the score of test takers? Test taking techniques that focus on test items. And also, it is important here to discover how frequently the longest option is the correct response. In this way, when we prepare our students in order to increase the scores of the test, we are going to use some strategies for them to increase the test. We are helping them with some strategies, but we are not helping them with the use of language. As you can see here, match lexical items in the stem to synonyms in the key. So they are just strategies to score the test. So our students will be more focused on these strategies in order to obtain higher scores. But what we have to consider here is that it is more important to provide students with opportunities to practice. If you provide your students with opportunities to practice, if you provide your students with activities in which the five principles of language assessment are considered, if you apply these five principles of language assessment for testing and also for designing different activities as a daily basis, you will be helping your students to be prepared for the test. I consider that it is better to familiarize our learners with the test, with different types of activities every day, and these same activities or similar activities have to be considered for the test. So they are familiar, we can work with the kind of instructions for them to be familiar with the responses that they have to provide. I think that this is better. Yeah, because if we prepare them just with some strategies, we are preparing them to get higher scores, but maybe we are not focusing on the objective. They have to produce. They have to understand what they are reading or what they are listening to. We have to prepare them in order to use the language, not just to follow some strategies in order to obtain higher scores. In relation to the test, we have to select the test. We have to consider some criteria, okay? Remember that we have been talking about the purpose, the test purpose. This is the first step that I have to consider. What is my purpose? What I would like to know, okay? And after that, I have to consider my students' characteristics. Remember these multiple intelligences, or I have also to consider their needs. I have to analyze all of this. After that, we have to be aware of the construct of interest, communicative competence. I'm going to focus on fluency, on their competence to write in English, on their competence to use spoken language. So this construct have to be considered in order to decide on what test to use or what test to design. Remember the principles of language assessment. We have to consider also the five principles, but here we are going to focus on reliability. Remember, the test has to be reliable, valid also. We have to consider the content. We have to analyze again all the content, all the skills that have been considered during the course in order to select the test. Also, the way in which we are going to administer the test. Are we going to use computers? Are we going to use just some papers for them to complete a task? This is the way, or these are the aspects that we have to consider. If we are going to use computers, so we have to be aware in advance that all this technology is ready for our students to take the test. So we have to make all these considerations in advance in order to avoid any possible problem the day of the test. Now, the impact is also necessary. Which is the impact of my test? It is going to be useful for my students? Is it going to have any positive impact for them and also for me in order to make some adjustment in my teaching? All of these considerations are very necessary, okay? Is it going to have any impact for them and also for me as teacher? If it is going to have a positive impact, so we have to select that test, or we have to select that type of items. Okay, this is all the information in a general way that I can share with you. Because of the time, it is not possible to provide you with more information. But remember that we will be working during 2 months. We are going to have many different activities, chats, videos. You have the opportunity to contact me through Eva. You can send me any message. You can contact me. I am going to provide with a number of extensions in which you can call in order to talk about your concerns. But now it is time for you to ask some questions, okay? If you have some questions, now you are free to ask them if you think that it is necessary, or maybe you can contact me through Eva and I will be ready to help you. Okay. If you don't have any questions related to the information that I provide you this afternoon, I would like to thank you for being here today, and I would like to let you know that you can contact me every time you need. I am here to help you. Maybe today you are going to analyze the information. Maybe you are going to analyze some more information in the guide. Okay, so I would like to ask you to check the distance evaluation also. If you have any questions related to the distance evaluation, if you have any questions related to the information that you have in the guide, you can contact me, okay? If you think that the information is not clear, if you think that the assignments or the instruction that I provided in order to work on the different assignments each week, you can contact me in order to avoid any future problems, okay? If you think that the information is not clear, or maybe you get a little confused in relation to the assignments, you can send me a message, you can contact me through Eva, and we will be able to find a solution. I can help you, I can give you some more clear directions for you to complete each one of the assignments, okay? I would like also to suggest you to work every day, okay? Don't wait until the due date in order to work on the assignment. Remember that the assignments are not difficult. The assignments are not difficult, but they are going to take a little time to you. So what you have to do is to analyze what you have to do in each assignment. Remember that you have to look for some tests. You have to analyze the test, which is not difficult, but it is going to take you some time. So I suggest you to work every day in order to send the assignment on time, okay? If you don't have questions, I would like to thank you, and please contact me if you think it is necessary. Participate also on the activities that have been planned, because they are going to help you to learn from your classmates. If you participate in every chat, if you participate in the video, in the forums, and also in the wiki, you will be able to learn from your classmates, and also you will be able to provide your classmates with more information about your experience. Remember that you are English teachers, and your experience will be really useful for all your classmates. What you can share in chats or in videos will be very useful, very important for your students, because they can adapt their teaching, they can adjust their teaching, and you can help them. In our chats and also in our videos, we will be providing our experience, we will be providing our opinions, and also the way in which we work with our students. In this way, your classmates will learn from you, and they will be able to improve their teaching and also to improve their way of assessing students, okay? Thank you very much, and we are going to continue working next week. Remember that next week on Wednesday, we are going to work on the first chat with class A. We are going to work from 5 p.m. until 6 p.m. and with class B, I am going to be working from 6 p.m. until 7 p.m. I already sent you information about the first chat, okay? So you have to check that information, and during the chat, we will be working with that topic, okay? Thank you very much, and we will be in contact next week.